What this dying world could use is a willing man of God who dares to go against the grain and work without applause. A man who raised the shield of faith, protecting what is pure, whose love is tough and gentle, a man whose word is sure. God doesn't need an orator who knows just what to say. He doesn't need authorities to reason him away. He doesn't need an army to guarantee a win. He just needs a few good men. And men full of compassion who laugh and love and cry. Men who face eternity, they aren't afraid to die. Men who fight for freedom in honor once again. He just needs a few good men. He calls the broken derelict whose life has been renewed. He calls the one who has the strength to stand up for the truth. Enlisted lines are open and he wants you to come in. He just needs a few good men. Men full of compassion who laugh and love and cry. Men who face eternity and aren't afraid to die. And men who fight for freedom in honor once again. He just needs a few good men. And men full of compassion who laugh and love and cry. And men who face eternity and aren't afraid to die. Men who fight for freedom and honor once again. He just needs a few good men. Men full of compassion who laugh and love and cry. And men who face eternity, they're not afraid to die. And men who fight for freedom and honor once again. He just needs a few good men. Oh, he just needs a few good men. He just needs a few.
Change colors when someone's watching, please. Now. Hey, I watched Sunday morning, by the way, and this man, Pastor Farley, did he do a great job or what? Stand up, let everyone know who you are. Yeah. You the man, John. Someone said to me, I only traveled with one person, so now you know who it was. But they said, wow, John's really mad this morning. I said, no, he's intense, and he was. He did a great job. I was proud of him, and I was thankful for you because you have allowed him to exercise his gift, as well as Pastor Shagru, so that they can have that confidence to be able to concentrate on what they're saying rather than having subjectivity because wondering whether or not they're going to be accepted. So you should give yourself a nice hand, not now, but at home, stand in the mirror and go, me, all right? Arizona, thank you very much for those of you who may be listening right now and watching in, later on in the day. And we had a great time, enjoyed ourselves, and they have a lot of positive Volition there, a lot of young people that I'm very grateful for. And they have a desire to know God. It was an incredible time, totally busy with fellowship and teaching, and it was just a great time to see all those people. Friday evening, there's no class, so mark that down. There'll be no class this evening. All right, turn in your Bibles. I mean, no class Friday evening. All right, turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 4. We'll take a moment of silent prayer as we normally do to give ourselves the opportunity to enter into fellowship with God if necessary, which means naming and citing any known sins. For the Word of God says, if we confess our sins, that God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. With that in mind, let us pray. Father, thank you. You've given us the privilege of living in this nation, a nation that is about to celebrate its freedom, a nation where, in spite of all the evil and the chaos that is trying to come upon our country that we live in and upon the people, it's still being blessed by you. We're seeing tremendous freedom because of the fact that you have laid down your life by sending your son, and that you have given us the opportunity to believe in him and then lay down our lives for one another. And a part of that laying down our lives is the military establishment. We thank you for them because they are the main reason why we have become a free nation. So as we enter into this holiday this week, we do pray that we will be reminded of the principle of freedom, why we are free, and then the ultimate freedom because we walk in your truth and that truth sets us free. So thank you, Father, for this privilege of gathering together this evening in the realm of freedom. We do pray that God, the Holy Spirit, would enlighten us with the information that we are about to note and challenge all of us with it. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. There's one more very important principle that we need to note before we get our basic outline of dispensations finished. And this is related again to the first dispensation or the first category of dispensations, which of course are called theocentric dispensation and dispensations. We are in the first category of the theocentric dispensation. We call the dispensation, by the way, this category, the dispensation of the Gentiles, because the Jewish race had not yet begun. Again, it's broken down into three parts: the period of positive volition, Adam and the woman in the garden, the period of negative volition, where we see the fact that the Jews did not exist as of yet, and it's still a time of the Gentiles, all the way from Adam and the woman in the garden to Abraham, Isaac, and the period of the patriarchs and Jacob. That is the third period, the period of the patriarchs. Now, the age of negative volition is part, therefore, of the dispensation of the Gentiles, which we are noting. And this evening, I want you to understand one very important principle that is related to this first dispensation. This period, by the way, of negative volition is the era of the dispensation of the first murder in history. And that is very vital when it comes to the principle of how God preserves a nation and how God comes through and protects that nation. This was the first era. This dispensation of the Gentiles was the era of the dispensation of the first murder in all of human history in Genesis 4, 1 through 15. This, of course, refers to the fact that Cain actually murdered his brother Abel. We saw that last Friday. And the Bible says that Cain did murder his brother Abel, and he was of the evil one. And then it says in 1 John 3:12, why did he murder his brother? And he did it with that sacrificial knife, because his deeds, His form of worshiping God, by the way, were evil. They were religious. But those of his brother were honorable and righteous. So remember that Cain in 1 John 3:12, the first part of the verse, says that Cain was of the evil one. He was influenced by the god of this world, whom Adam turned over the rulership of this world to, Satan himself, and he was influenced by satanic thinking, and he murdered his brother. In 1 John 3:12, it tells us the reason why. So that we read, let's look at Genesis 4, verse 3. We read, and this is important to note because I want you to see that this has to do with worshiping God in the realm of thankfulness for our salvation. Not just, God is not forbidding to take what you have earned and worship him with it. And that's what a lot of people have about say about Cain. Well, he just worshiped God with what he had. No, he had to understand the principle of sacrificial offering. And so we see that it came about in the course of time. We have no idea how long that is. That Cain brought an offering to the Lord of the fruit of the ground. Now that's interesting. He brought an offering to the Lord. So he had to believe that the Lord actually existed. He brought an offering to him. And Abel on his part also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of their fat portions. Now Abel just so happened to have the ability to offer the animal sacrifice, which represented the blood of Jesus Christ. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering. But for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. What happened to Cain? He became very angry and his countenance fell. And many times, by the way, you can recognize a person filled with anger just by looking at them or filled with jealousy. In fact, the physical systems of anger range anywhere from people who have mild heart attacks to ulcers, high blood pressure. They let things get the best of them, and the next thing you know, they have a heart attack. Why? Where did that come from? Not from what they ate physically, but what they ate spiritually or what they ate in the natural realm. All kinds of problems in their mental attitude. So then the Lord said to Cain, now remember, we're talking about a certain dispensation. What's unique about this dispensation, this period of time? Well, first of all, there is no Bible. And not only that, but we have God himself. In every dispensation, God reveals to us and shows us that no matter what way he reveals himself to mankind, mankind will still reject him. Here we have God talking to the unbeliever, an unbeliever. Here we have God talking to an unbeliever and saying something to him. And he sees the Lord saying something to him. He hears it. And the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why has your countenance fallen? If you do well," which is to follow the principles of spirituality as it was in that day concerning the sacrifices, "will not your countenance be lifted up? And if you do well, sin. If you do not do well, sin." That sin nature and the temptation to sin is crouching at the door. And its desire, the sin nature, sin, is for you. But you better master it. And Cain told Abel, his brother, in verse 8. This is a little bit after because he told Cain told Abel, his brother, a few times. That's the Hebrew verb right there. "And it came about when they were in the field." Notice he told Abel, his brother, about the fact that the Lord did not accept his sacrifice. "And it came about that when they were in the field, that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and not killed him," says the Hebrew, "but murdered him." He murdered him. Cain murdered his brother. Why? Because Abel fulfilled the proper form of worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. He fulfilled the principle of worship and the Lord Jesus Christ being judged for our sins, because whether you understand it or not, we have the only, and I'll identify or I'll categorize us as a religion, though we are not, but we have the only religion where God, our God, became a man and paid the price for sin and blood was shed for us. No other religion has that. They have what religion stands for, a system of good deeds. Actually, what you have to do is you have to be good. You have to go forward and you have to change your life. You have to get rid of all these bad habits. You can't do this or that or go here and there. And that is nothing more than mankind trying to impress God with his works and his deeds. And God cannot be impressed with sick heads. and he cannot be depressed with deceitful hearts. He cannot, I mean, impressed. He can be depressed by deceitful hearts, that's for sure. He cannot be impressed. He's not going to be impressed by the sick head and the deceitful heart. There's only one thing that mankind could ever do to have fellowship with God, and that which is, impresses God properly, and that is trusting in the fact that his son would become a blood sacrifice so that we could have eternal life. So the principle is very simple. You see, Abel offered an animal sacrifice, representing blood, representing, by the way, the life in Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, the life of the flesh is in the blood. That's talking about animal life. Your life is in your head. It's in your soul. The animal does not have the ability to have a soul like you and I do. He doesn't reach God consciousness. So Abel offered an animal sacrifice while Cain only offered up human good. What did he offer up? His work or his produce, what he did from the ground. That would be all right after worship, if you're worshiping God and you're saved and now you offer up the blood sacrifice or you believe in Christ, then you offer up that which you have earned or that which God has blessed you with. But Cain wanted to do that for the sake of being accepted with God. Now look at Genesis 4, verse 8. So Cain told his brother Abel, and it came about when they were in the field, he rose up against Abel, his brother, and killed him. Cain was a great farmer. Offering up human works instead of a blood sacrifice is like an individual today believing that mankind can be just before God by his works. And you say, my relatives believe in God. They believe that God exists. You see, Cain believed that God existed. Cain talked with God. Believing that God exists or believing that Jesus Christ exists is one thing. Trusting in him, relying on him, and having him be your Lord and Savior is totally something different. And to do so, he's going to tell you the right thing and how to do the right thing in the right way. And offering up your deeds and your goodness and how great thou art does not impress God. The right thing is the animal sacrifice or believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. And the right way is for you to come to a point where you follow God's directions. You do it God's way. Why was it that in the church of Corinth, many died the sin unto death? Because they took the bread, they took the blood, they did the communion service, but they did not discern what it was all about. They had ritual without reality. So I don't care how good your grandmother was or your great-grandmother or your aunt or your uncle and how they went to church every day. That may have impressed you. It doesn't impress God. God is more impressed by the murderer who's on his dying bed and about to die from capital punishment. He's more impressed with that person who believes in Jesus Christ and in 1 second is justified than he is with the lifetime of a person that doesn't think that they really need a sacrifice. They don't need a savior. They can get there on their own. Human works, Isaiah 64:6, is totally disgusting to God. Not to man. Man is impressed with human good, but God is not. And so Cain offered to the Lord a result of, for salvation now, not for spirituality. He offered to the Lord the result of his own sweat and toil. Remember in Genesis 3:19, man was to live by the sweat of his brow. What did that represent? That represented a curse. And religion represents a curse. And any form of teaching that doesn't promote faith alone and Christ alone, and that's it, is a curseful teaching. And so in the immediate era following the fall with Adam and the woman, we have envy, we have jealousy, we have arrogance, and this was the motive for the first murder. He envied his brother. He was jealous of him, and he was very, very proud. Now here's the interesting principle that I want you to note. I want you to see this, and I want you to go to Genesis chapter 9. Here's what I want to point out to you this evening that I think is important in understanding dispensations. And remember that man's viewpoint is not God's viewpoint. God's word and God's thoughts are way beyond man's thoughts. So when God says something that you disagree with, you're wrong, and so am I. And there's one major principle we're going to see this evening, and that is the fact that there's certain laws that God has established, and they are actually for every dispensation. not for the spiritual life, but for every dispensation. And I want you to notice that this was also, this killing is also the beginning in history of capital punishment. Capital punishment has been authorized from the time of the first murder, when Cain killed Abel, right down to this moment. And when a nation or an establishment actually becomes sentimental towards someone who has taken a life. Well, you know, someone murders two people, but they really didn't mean it. And, don't take their life away. What about the two people? What about the victims and the fact that their parents or their wife or their husband or their children are never going to see the ones who were killed and murdered by that individual for the rest of their life? We always begin to have sentiment toward the criminal. We forget the victims. That's called injustice. And now look at Genesis 9, verse 5. Here's what the Lord says. I will surely, I will require your lifeblood. From every beast I will require it, even the animals. And from every man's brother, I will require the life of man. Whoever sheds man's blood... And that is not killing in war, that is murder. Whoever sheds man's blood, by his blood shall he be shed. Why? For in the image of God, he made man. When you kill another member of the human race, you're killing someone whom God has created to live. And this is how crime, by the way, must be controlled. This is the first statement in the first dispensation of capital punishment. Every animal, notice what it says in verse 4, even every animal that murders at that particular dispensation, even domestic animals were also executed. A murderer, therefore, was to be executed. He was not to be rehabilitated, not counseled, but executed. And by the way, if they didn't know what they were doing, God says they still have to pay the price. It's a matter of keeping the principles of freedom and establishment and immorality down, but freedom and establishment is based upon whether or not a nation follows through on the principles that God has designed. And there's payment for certain things. And by the way, if we followed God's laws in every dispensation, I'm not talking about the spiritual laws, the natural laws, you'd find out we wouldn't even need prisons. We wouldn't need prisons at all. People would have a fear that Paul said in Romans 13, we church-age believers alive today in the United States of America in the year of our Lord, 2008, the law was given for the criminal to fear. And if we had fear that we were going to have to face some real tough consequences, a lot of people would think twice before they committed that act. You see, they would not say, well, I'll only get 3 years. I'll be out in 3 years, and then I'll be able to do A, B, C, D, and E. I'll be set for life. No, there wouldn't be any thinking like that whatsoever. So a murderer was not to be executed, not to be rehabilitated, not counseled, but executed. And if we executed everyone who committed murder, and everyone, by the way, as the Bible says, who rapes another person, the rapist, by the way, would not go forward with their rape if they did so. And I'm talking about, remember, the laws. When I say if everyone that commits a murder or commits a rape, they have to, by the way, follow the laws of Jewish jurisprudence. What is that? You could not do what some women have done, rip their shirts and call 911. You had to have two or three eyewitnesses that saw it. Or two or three eyewitnesses that saw the rape or saw the murder. They were guilty because of eyewitnesses, not hearsay, but because of eyewitnesses. And Genesis 6, therefore, actually is teaching that we would find that crime in any civilization would decrease drastically if we followed God's laws. And Genesis 9, verse 6 is the beginning of capital punishment. This is not about killing in war, by the way. The commandment, thou shalt not kill, is incorrectly translated. If you're like me, I grew up in a certain denomination that wanted me to learn the Ten Commandments. Then when I grew up and found out what the Word of God says, I had to unlearn those things and found out that it did not say what I thought it said. The Bible does not say, thou shalt not kill. Oh, the King James translation says it in Exodus 20:13, you shall not kill. But the New American Standard says, you shall not ratsack R-A-T-S-A-C-H, you shall not murder. And therefore, the execution of criminals in any dispensation is a must. As a matter of fact, that's why the Jews had a very low crime rate and they had no prisons. If leaders got caught actually in perjury, or if they got caught taking bribes, they had to pay a price. They were not pardoned by someone else who has taken a bribe and committed perjury. They were actually individuals who had to pay that penalty. If they stole, they had their hand cut off. Now, I don't know about you, but if we had a law that says if you steal something, and it's stealing according to the laws of God, someone sees it, they witness it, and you steal something, you get your hand cut off, I think twice. I wouldn't go around with no hands. I think twice. And a lot of people would think twice if we operated under these particular laws that God has designed for every dispensation. Now, for those of you, and by the way, the reason for all of this, the reason is given in verse 6, why God actually respects and honors life is because man was made in the image of God. For in the image of God, he created man. Now, for those of you who think that's very unloving, let's see what our Lord and Savior, the God of all compassion and mercy, had to say. What did he say about this principle? Go forward to Matthew 26. So I want you to note this principle before we go on to our next subject, our next period of time, which we're going to go through a little bit more quickly. But I want you to see this principle, that a change in dispensation did not change the law of capital punishment. In every dispensation, including the millennial reign, including the tribulation period, including the church age, including the hypostatic union, including the age of Israel, including the Old Testament age of Gentiles, a change in dispensation did not change the law of capital punishment. Now in Matthew 26, look at verse 52, our Lord is speaking to Peter. Peter wanted to do something good. You see, Peter intended to defend the Lord with his life. And when the temple policeman stepped forward to seize our Lord, Peter pulled out a sword. First thing he did was cut off the soldier's ear. His name, by the way, was Malchus. When I first got saved, I was always impressed with that guy. I said, I wonder if he got saved. And you might say, why? Because when Peter cut off his ear, Jesus bent down, took the ear, put it back on. Now, I don't know about you, but that's the gospel to me. Someone cuts off my ear, it's lying on the ground, and I'm bleeding, and someone else picks it up, puts it on. I want to follow that guy. That's not a trick, you know. I was bleeding, I couldn't hear, and his name was Malchus. So Peter took out his sword and cut off the soldier's ear, and the Lord said to him, in verse 52, put your sword back into its place. Why? Because all of those who take up the sword shall perish by the sword. And he's talking about the unlawful use of the sword. He's talking about the unlawful use of weapons. You see, the unlawful use of weapons, crime, violence, terrorism, rape, murders, all of these categories draw the sword illegally. What do they do when they commit crime? They use a sword. They use a gun. Violence, they're using a sword and gun. Terrorism, rape, what do they do with the terrorists? All of those terrorists should have been put to death, and that was it. I like what Rick told me when he told me about one of the military stories about the fact that when they caught the terrorists or the Muslims in the Philippines, they actually had 20 of them or so. I don't know the exact number, so don't quote me. Don't correct me on it, okay? It's the principle, not the numbers. There were 22. No, there were 23. One of them was pregnant. You see, now we get into life in the womb, and then we get all sidetracked by these issues. There's 20. All right, there's 20 of them. And what they did is that they wrapped 19 of them in pigskin. If a Muslim dies and if they have any contact with pig, they can't go to that place with the 80,000 virgins waiting for them. They have to go to hell because, you see, their God says, if someone wraps you in pigskin, your life of dedication to me is over. And so he actually did that to 19 of the soldiers, and he let the other one free. And he said, I want you to go back, and I want you to tell the people what we just did. They never had another problem with terrorism. Why? Because the people lived in fear that they would die. But what is terrorism? If we put to death every person that was a terrorist, they wouldn't come in our country. But no, we have to have lawyers for them. We have to give them a judicial system and the best judicial system in the world. We have to make sure that they have all their rights taken care of. We have to imprison them and give them good food. We have to take care of them. And then we, the United States of America, the citizens in this nation, we have to pay that they have the finest defense made possible by our taxes and make sure they have a vehicle, make sure they're okay. Why? We don't want to upset the liberals. We don't want to upset those who are liberal and those who think everybody needs a fair chance and everyone's going to be equal. Everyone should be equal. Everyone is not going to be equal. It will never happen. There's no such thing because people have a sin nature. And when you give them equality, some use it in one measure one way, some use it in another measure another way, taking advantage of the situation, etc. And then the next thing you know, we're all unequal again. What do? Start all over again? All right, let's go equal again. Where are we going to get the money? Those who succeeded with their freedom. And it's a big, big circle. The Bible teaches that weapons, when they use, when the unlawful use of weapons and crime and violence and terrorism and rape and murder, all of these categories draw the sword completely. And that's what the Bible is teaching. All who draw the sword shall die by the sword. That's how you control crime. This was when Jesus Christ was on the earth. I did not say that. He said that. And this means criminals who use weapons, and they use weapons to make people live in fear, should actually die. Now, this is a perfect illustration of the fact that every dispensation has not they don't have all the laws. We're not, God does not expect us to follow some of those in the Old Testament. How do you know? They're not repeated in the New. But every dispensation has certain divine laws which apply to all of them. Now, go back to Genesis chapter 4. Now, I want you to note this because this is important in the subject of dispensations. We're not going to spend any more time on this one, but I want you to see capital punishment began in Genesis 9. That's when it began. It began in Genesis 9. It continued in the Mosaic Law. There's your theocentric dispensation from Adam all the way to when Israel became a nation. It continued in the Mosaic Law. Exodus 21:15. Then when our Lord walked the face of the earth, when we have the Christocentric dispensation, Christ in the man, it continued in the hypostatic union. Undiminished deity, a true humanity, was our Lord forever. Then Paul said, I want it to be practiced in Romans 13:1-8, in the dispensation of the church. It continues in the church age. It will also be involved in the tribulation, where terrorism is dealt with by capital punishment. And then in Revelation 2:26-28, capital punishment will even be practiced in the millennium, by the way, that 1,000-year period. And someone may ask, well, if they're going to live 1,000 years, are they going to die? Will they be under that capital punishment? How do we know? They will. Because the Bible says in Isaiah 65:20, talking about the millennial reign, the 1,000-year period, no longer will there be an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who does not live out his days. For the youth will die at the age of 100. Notice, they'll die at the age of 100. Someone dies during that 1,000-year reign, which is about to come upon the earth. They die at the age of 100. And the one who does not reach the age of 100, they shall be thought accursed. Why? Because these will be individuals, as Revelation 2:26-28 says back here, that will have the Lord Jesus Christ, who's ruling as a member of the human race, seated on a throne in Jerusalem, practicing capital punishment. Now, that's God's view. You can ask yourself what view you want. You can justify anything you want. I know my view. My view is based upon the fact that God says that. Are there cases where it's unjust? I'm sure there are. There's injustice everywhere. When children get killed in war the elderly die in war, etc., that's what war is all about. No one says that life's going to be filled with total fairness and justice. But one of the ways to make it filled with freedom is to practice God's laws of divine establishment. And so wherever people have old sin natures, running wild, they are going to continue to commit murder. And they who do so shall be executed. So I want you to see that establishment principles here actually remain basically the same throughout the dispensations. The difference in dispensations is God's plan for you, God's plan for the believers, not the laws of divine establishment. They still operate and they are still in view when it comes to the doctrine of dispensations. The biblical concept then, the mind of Christ, how he controls human history through his word, is capital punishment. And capital punishment began with the first murder. Now, many people have this question, and they have a lot of questions about certain things that you have to answer and be prepared. If murder demands capital punishment, then why did God allow Cain to keep on living? Anyone? If murder demands capital punishment, then why did God allow Cain to keep on living? Well, look at verse 15. And by the way, the reason why he did so, I'll give it to you, is the fact that there was no law. There was no rule. There was no law that God had established up to that point. So once the first murder came into effect, then God put the law into effect. Genesis 4:15 says, so the Lord said to him, notice this, Cain is now rejected by the Lord, drives him out of the Lord's presence. The Lord said to him, therefore, whoever kills Cain, vengeance will be taken on him sevenfold. You kill Cain, you and your family are going to have problems. The Lord therefore appointed a mark or a sign for Cain, lest anyone finding him should murder him. Here's the principle, the mark of Cain. The reason why Cain was not executed again was because there had not been a law up to the time of Cain. The mark of Cain, what was it? The mark of Cain was the mark of divine protection, not a mark of violence. You see, people, here we come again with mankind, well, he committed the first murder and God put a mark upon his face, so it must have been something really ugly. And we always think, you know, we commit a certain act and here's what God does. The mark of Cain was not a deformed face. The mark of Cain was the mark of divine protection, not a mark of violence. Secondly, the mark of Cain permits Cain to remain alive so that he can have an opportunity to be saved. Did you ever wonder why certain people live a long time and they have a lot of money and they don't die, they just keep on going forward and you wonder what's happening, how come God hasn't dealt with them like he's dealt with me? He puts me through suffering, heartaches, difficulties, the wicked prosper, I'm trying to get by. Do you ever wonder why? Do you ever think that was God's long-suffering and patience because he wills all men to be saved? And that probably the ones who lived the longer were the most wicked? And probably that God wants them to be born again and saved, and if not, this is their heaven, because where they're going to, they will not experience any form of happiness whatsoever. So the mark of Cain permits Cain to remain alive so that God can give him, he can have an opportunity to be saved. And that the third principle here that I love is this: God's grace permits the unbeliever to live on the earth even in direct defiance of God. God is not like us. You want to defy me? You come against me? You've had it. Pay the price. Nope. God's grace permits the unbeliever to live on the earth, even if the unbeliever is in direct defiance of God. Cain always defiled God. He didn't take his word seriously. And as long as he was alive, he could always be saved by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. So God, in his very own righteousness, remember I said his laws are not our laws, his ways are not our ways, his thoughts are not our thoughts. God, in his very own righteousness, gives the most wicked people in your life, the unbelievers in your life, he gives them every chance to be saved. Because you see, he loves them just as much as he loves you. Another principle, and that is this. Your pastor has to have a drink of water. That's the principle. No. God took punishment into his own hands. God took the punishment into his own hands and protected the human race from further violence at that time. Why? By administering that perfect punishment, the punishment is perfect because God is perfect. A perfect God can only administer perfect punishment, and his punishment comes through his justice, which is totally perfect. And so by administering that punishment himself, God keeps the human race from entering into a warfare over whether the justice of God is correct or not, or whether they should kill someone based upon the fact that they heard someone else killed someone. No, God actually keeps the human race from entering into a warfare over whether or not his justice is correct. So people are always interested in one thing, and this is a shocker, what the mark of Cain really was. And may I say, and I am embarrassed to say, what the so-called theologians and some of the people that some of you respect have to say what the mark of Cain was and what they have to say about it. It's embarrassing, so embarrassing, I won't even mention it. It's impossible to tell whether or not it was a physical mark, but I guarantee you it's not what these self-righteous, legalistic, judgmental individuals had to say. It's not some, it may have been some physical mark, some sign upon the body, but it indicated this. Now notice, it indicated that he was God's property. He was God's property. Or he was something else, but he was God's property. And God put a mark upon him so that when people saw it, they had to stay away. He was God's property. Maybe he had a hopeless, pathetic look or something. Maybe it was something that was overt that people had pity on. We simply do not know. But we do know it was a mark from God. And by the way, even the guilty are still God's property. Don't forget that. This is another lesson that we can learn. God still has love for the unbeliever, even though the unbeliever has committed sin against God. And so we have to understand that God throws a circle of protective love about Cain. He throws it right around Cain. Cain has a circle of protective love. What's the circle? Yes, he's guilty, he's a murderer, but he's still my property. Don't forget it in your dealings with him. And by the way, that is great to apply to you in your life. Yes, that person is guilty. That person may be a liar, a deceiver, but he's God's property. She's God's property. You leave your hands off. God will determine when they will reap what they sow. God might be dealing with that person, whether believer or unbeliever, just like he's dealing with Cain. I'm still going to keep you alive to become a winner believer. I'm still going to give you a chance. So it's no one else's business. Cain, what? You're guilty. Yes, you are guilty. You're an unbeliever. Yes, you are. You're a murderer. Yes, you are. But you're still my property. And don't forget it in your dealings with him, he says to other members of the human race. Don't ever forget your dealings with other people, especially if they are born again and saved, because they are God's property. And you may want to try to get even or hurt them or do something against them, but they are the property of God. So I believe the mark of Cain was not a mark of shame. I believe it was something that actually was a blessing that kept him alive, something that caused mankind not to do evil things against him because of the fact that they knew about the first murder committed in the human race. Go to 2 Peter chapter 3. So I think the mark was actually a mark of grace by which God is saying, this man is still my property, hands off. You say, what about souls? What about the unbeliever? God says in the book of Ezekiel chapter 18, all souls belong to me, they're all mine. The Muslim, the atheist, the agnostic, the Christian, the person who does not believe that there is a God, or the person who believes in a false religion, they still belong to God. So the issue is hands off. Malt upon, give them the gospel. Life upon, share with them the happiness that you have by the way that you live. But don't judge them, hands off. And therefore, I believe that the main reason why God protected Cain was in order to give him time to think and to repent. That is always the policy of God. And notice what Peter says in 2 Peter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but he's patient toward you, is patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. Never ever make the mistake of regarding the long-suffering of God and the patience of God in your life and in other people's lives as though they're getting away with anything. God has given us grace and patience and kindness. God does not say, I forget all those negative decisions with the negative consequences that will come in your life at a certain period of time. But he's saying this, don't take lightly his grace, his mercy, his long-suffering and his patience. Don't take it lightly when it comes to your personal life and how he's been all of that to you. And don't take it lightly when it comes to the unbeliever. They might be remaining alive because they have to have that opportunity to believe in Christ, even if it is on their dying bed. Therefore, we really have no right to conclude who's in heaven and who's in hell, because we don't know what they did the last minute of their life. It could have been faith alone and Christ alone, and that's it, they're saved. Losers, yes, and with no rewards, but they'll be fantastically happy forever and ever, but they are born again and they're living with God forever. So never mistake the regarding of the long-suffering of God, as Peter says in verse 9, as though people are getting away with something. Peter says it's rather his mercy, his grace, giving individuals time to repent, change their system of thinking, and so that none may perish, but all may come to repentance. What did God do? God did to an unbeliever what he does to us. He gives us space with his grace. He gives us the grace of God. He gives us that grace, and he gives us the space, the time, to actually reach a point where we dogmatically have all the information needed to make a decision. Now, back in Genesis 4, and here's where we will close. Whatever that mark was, it again indicated to people the reason that even though Cain was a murderer, God spared his life. So I want you to see this principle again. Whatever the mark of Cain was, it is the principle that is important, not the actual mark. You know, I've learned this as I travel throughout the country and talk to people. A lot of times you use an illustration, and people focus in on the illustration, but not the principle. It's not the illustration that matters. That's like a parable. And you see, there's a story to prove a principle. It's the principle behind it. You might have to make decisions in your life, and all of a sudden someone says, well, why are you picking on me? And you're not picking on them. There's a principle behind what you're saying or what you're not saying. And people miss out on the principle. Everyone's concerned on what the mark was. That's not the issue. The issue is not the mark. The issue is not the actual mark. The issue is the principle. Why did God do that? Well, we have that principle answered because of his love, his grace, and his mercy, even in the first category of dispensations. It was Cain's works in merit against God, against the blood sacrifice. And in the age of negative volition, a part of the dispensation of the Gentiles, that first murder was committed, and that first murder was due to what? A religious dispute. Think about that. Why was the first murder committed? Did it have anything to do with the fact that a person stole money, or he stole his man's wife, or he did something evil to the children? Was he immoral? No. What was the reason for the first murder in all of human history in the first dispensation? Here it was. It was Cain's works and merits, religion, against Abel's bloody sacrifice or faith toward trusting in God for the sacrifice for his sin. Our biggest enemy as a grace-oriented congregation will be religion. And religion has crept into this local assembly. It's crept into all kinds of doctrinal churches that I've seen. And religion is something evil that you need to identify. Religion is man trying to impress God by what he does, rather than humbling himself and following the word of God. They don't want to submit to pastors today. They don't want to become a part of a local assembly. They don't want to use their time and talent and their treasure to give, expecting nothing in return. They want to impress God by those things. They think they can impress God by their knowledge of the word, or what they give when they're not a part of the spiritual life, or how they serve, or the good deeds that they have done. And it's evil, and you're making war against the people of God. The main enemy that the Lord faced was religion. The main enemy that Paul faced, religion. The early church, religion. Religion is the greatest enemy in the world today. It's still around. What's the greatest enemy right now? We have a religion. People wanting to blow up everybody else because that's what their religion says to do. Especially if you're a Christian and Jew. That sounds like a poem. I'm a poet. I don't even know it. I made a rhyme for a second time. How good I am. Now, why do you think all these people want me to travel all over the place? They want to be in the presence of such glory. Yeah, right. They'll take that out of context. They won't have the rest of it. Who the hell cares? God's work, it was Cain's works against Abel's bloody sacrifice, and God does not accept that. Cain claimed that his offering, his deeds, were worthy enough from the soil which God had given him. They were sufficient enough to worship God. But notice again, they did not worship God, because what worships God in the realm of salvation is one thing, faith alone in Christ alone. So please notice something unique about this dispensation. The Lord Jesus Christ even tried to reason with unbelievers. Personally, they heard his voice. You and I would just hope that he would say hello and we'd hear his voice. He had conversations with the unbelievers, and they still remain unbelievers, illustrating the fact that no matter what God does for the human race, we simply are impossible to please. You know, when someone says, he's impossible, she's impossible, you should say, duh, yeah, what else? The Bible teaches that mankind is impossible to please. Different policies in every different dispensation or period of time. Perfect environment without the devil. They had perfect environment with the devil in the garden. God gives perfect environment without the devil. Mankind's upset. Then you have the fact that I'm going to give you the greatest assets that anyone has ever had, and you'll be right on top with me. You'll be next to me. You have a throne of grace. You can approach it boldly. You have the same privilege and same opportunity as every other person in all of human history. In fact, even greater. No, I don't have time. Well, I'm too busy. See, I'm too busy. That's what a lot of people say. I'm too busy. I'm too busy with the fact that Satan is controlling my life through his system of thinking and taking me away from real life and what happiness is all about. And so, again, the Lord Jesus Christ tries to reason. He puts a certain group of people with no law. They don't turn out right, the Gentiles. Then another group of people with the law, how to please God, they don't turn out right. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what God does until mankind, until we all are willing to humble ourselves and listen to his voice and follow his word and get it in our soul. There's no way that we're ever going to honor him, please him, and live in the manner that he desires us to live for our happiness, for our contentment, because he loves us. What more could he do for his vineyard, says Isaiah 5:4. What more can God do for his people? What is a vineyard? It's supposed to be something, a place that produces fruit. And what more could God do for his people, Isaiah the prophet said, than what he has done? What more can God do for us than what he's done? We've got tremendous blessings in our life, but we're right now condemned, or we're guilty about the fact that we did not enjoy those blessings, or we are enjoying those blessings and we could care less about God. Some people feel guilty and condemned because they don't appreciate the things of God. How do you change that? Appreciate the things of God. It's very simple. Other people think that they should have more. They would appreciate the things of God. They would not. You see, God reveals in this dispensation what Genesis 4, verse 5 and 6 says. Cain and his offering, God had no regard. Cain becomes angry instead of believing on Jesus Christ. The Lord now, notice, reasons with him. Why are you angry? He doesn't say, who art thou talking to me? Why are you angry? Why is your countenance falling? Again, if you do well, will not your countenance be lifted up? And God's warning him right there, the unbeliever. And what does he do? He goes out and he commits murder in verse 8. He murders Abel, his brother. And I want you to see, the Bible tells us the reason why. Satan was not only the instigator of the first murder, he was also the author of Cain's religion. Operation Fig Leaves in the garden. Put something on with your deeds, your works, and you can be accepted for God. God said, take that apron off, those fig leaves off. You have to have a blood sacrifice to be accepted by me. Now, that blood sacrifice was not literal blood. It was the person of Jesus Christ who was to come, who died for your sins on the cross. And I don't care how young you are or how old you are, you can believe upon that one principle and you will have eternal life. I'd like to have every head bowed, every eye closed. Thank you, Father, that you've given us this privilege of gathering together this evening. And for anyone who's here who's never been born again and saved, I'm here to tell you that like God loved Cain, an unbeliever, he loves you. And he wants you to know that he gave his uniquely born son, that whoever believes in him would never perish but have eternal life. You are a sinner, and you need to be saved. You cannot solve the problems by denial, by denying the fact that you've sinned and that you need a Savior. You can solve the problem one way and one way only, not by your deeds or your human works, but by the grace of God. He's offering to you this evening, wherever you are, he's offering to you this evening, right now, this time that you're listening to this message, eternal life. He's offering that to you as a gift. It is a gift, and God does not take his gifts back. It's the gift of God. You're saved by grace. You're saved by grace. You have been saved. It's through faith, believing what you're hearing right now. It's not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not as a result of what you can do to worship or to honor God, but as a result of God's grace, because he sent his son to die and pay the penalty for every single sin you've ever committed, past, present, and future. You can believe on the Lord Jesus, and you shall be saved. These things have been written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life, eternal life, in his name. So if you've said that right now, forming the sentences in thought only, and you recognize and humble yourself before God, and now you're going to trust and believe and rely upon his Son, Jesus Christ, then you have become a member of the Church of Jesus Christ, the royal family of God. And the only thing you should be concerned about right now is what God now wants you to think, how God wants you to live, and the tremendous blessings he has for you will be revealed as time goes on, and you'll see it's the greatest decision you've ever made. So thank you again, Father, for this privilege of gathering together as we celebrate the freedom that we have in this nation, but even the greater freedom that we have because of you sending your Son to give us the truth that sets us free. May your blessing be with each one as we leave right now. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen.